Lori, Rubenstein Fazzio is a very important part of both the yoga therapy certificate programs as well as the Master of Arts in Yoga Studies. She did advanced degrees in Australia as well as in the orbit of Harvard. She holds the doctorate of physical therapy and has undertaken various research projects and continues to inspire our students in so many fine ways.
Thank you, Chris, and thank you, Chris, Narinjan, and Sarah for all your hard work in putting this great conference together. Good morning. Which one? This one. There we go. So this morning, I'd like to talk a little bit about yoga therapy in the context of yoga therapy as a healthcare modality in the Western medical realm. So actually as a modality for the masses, not just as an alternative. As we heard Shanti Karkalsa say yesterday, most patients for yoga therapy come to us after they've tried everything else. So they hit rock bottom and they figure, okay, I'll try this now. Or they do it instead of conventional medicine. And I'd like to talk a little bit about ways that yoga therapy can be a modality for everybody, for the masses, not instead of, but in addition to. And so this definition, how many yoga therapists are here today, by the way? Just a few. Okay. So the International Association of Yoga Therapists, which was founded by our very own Larry Payne here and Richard Miller in 1989, this is their definition. And to kind of summarize it, I would say that it's extracting practices from yoga for health and well-being. So I differentiate it from yoga. So yoga therapy using practices of yoga for health and well-being. So does anybody know who this is? This is Martin Cooper. It has nothing to do with yoga therapy. He invented the cell phone in 1973. And that's the first cell phone there. It was sold for $4,000, and it was considered an unnecessary luxury. How many people have a cell phone today? Actually, there are 7.6 billion people on the planet, and there are 7.74 billion cell phone subscriptions. So that's more than one cell phone for every person on the planet. Now, Martin Cooper identified what he said, this is something that everybody needs. They just don't know they need it, back in 1973. And I like to propose that everybody needs yoga therapy. They just don't all know it yet. So. And some would say that this may be contributing, the cell phones may be contributing to what a huge problem is today that I'll be focusing on, which is lifestyle diseases. And as Dr. Kumar was saying about connection is so important, while we are technologically connected, we are personally disconnected. So there is some evidence that this our cell phones, it's actually changing our brains. There's actually in the Wall Street Journal today was an article about cell phones are hijacking our brains. And it's a bell curve. So if you don't use it, if you use it very little or if you use it a lot, it actually has detriment to your health as far as a cell phone. So this new problem today is lifestyle diseases, and it's not actually new, it's just escalating. So the majority of deaths worldwide are due to lifestyle diseases. And what that means, that's also non-communicable disease. Cardiovascular, cancer, respiratory, and diabetes are the main lifestyle diseases. And basically, these are things that are partially caused or largely caused by lifestyle. And yoga therapy, we teach people better lifestyle habits. So 82% of all deaths worldwide are attributed to lifestyle diseases. So as you can see, if yoga therapists are addressing lifestyle disease, that can be helping a majority of people in the world. One of the key factors of lifestyle disease is stress. And as we know, stress is a key factor in many diseases. In fact, 60 to 90% of all visits to primary care physicians are attributed to stress. However, only 3% include stress counseling. Of that 3%, those are patients who have multiple comorbidities, and basically the physician doesn't have any more options for them. Then they resort to stress management counseling. So what would it be like if there were a yoga therapist in every primary care physician's office, or at least they referred to a yoga therapist? So a patient gets their diagnosis and their medical treatment, and they get referred to or they see the yoga therapist so that the stress management can start right away before it ends up in lifestyle disease and death. And that's what we're working towards in educating yoga therapists so that they can effectively work with these patients. So that's not just my idea, but the World Health Organization is working on this. So they have their traditional medicine strategy. And part of their strategy is helping to get traditional medicine into primary care. And that includes Ayurveda, and that includes yoga, as well as shamanism and a multitude of traditional medicines I'm not even familiar with. So in their prior traditional medicine strategy, they found these risks. Unqualified practitioners. Well, that's one of the reasons that we have to have organizations such as the International Association of Yoga Therapists to help regulate and make sure that people are educated and have the tools. All it takes is somebody out there who's not qualified. It creates damage, it creates harm to somebody, and then, as you know, that becomes what everybody focuses on. Poor quality products. So a couple weeks ago, I was in a physician's office. He had asked me to come in and work with a patient with his to do some meditation. This is a very sick man. And when we started to talk about what we were going to do with meditation, he equated that to his experience years ago when he went to Dharamsala and he saw an Ayurvedic doctor. And he came home with some herbs that the doctor gave him. And his friend sent the herbs out to be evaluated. And the herbs came back with toxic levels of mercury. So he had a resistance, a hesitancy to work with me on meditation because he had an adverse experience. And all it takes, because as you all know, not all herbs are tainted with mercury. However, when someone has an experience like that, they are then hesitant to try any herbs. And that's why regulation's needed, so that the great herbs that you are all using, people can actually get access to. So part of their strategy is for education and training standards to regulate the qualifications. And I know we're all probably averse to regulation, yet to have these practices out to the masses, we do need that. And to support research and development. So this is in modern medicine, it's evidence-based medicine, and we need to have evidence. While there's only a small amount of evidence today as far as yoga, it's growing. It's growing really quickly, and that's really needed. So anybody out here, I know Satbir Khalsa will be talking about that later. It's really important so that people can actually use these practices. And again, getting it into primary care. So the International Association of Yoga Therapists started on this. They've already been working on this. So in 2012, they came out with their first educational standards that they updated in 2016. They started accrediting schools, and LMU's Yoga Therapy RX was one of the first schools to be accredited in 2014. They came out with a code of ethics in 2015, scope of practice, and they started certifying yoga therapists this year. So where is this going from here? So as Confucius says, study the past if you would define the future. So how did this all evolve? So yoga therapy. So it actually started out with a 200-hour, this is in the United States, by the way, with a 200-hour yoga teacher training, just 200 hours. Then that went to 500 hours. And now today, for yoga therapists, the C-IAYT, it's 1,000 hours. There also is a Master of Science degree at the Maryland University of Integrative Health. And then here at LMU, we have a Master's in Yoga Studies with a postgraduate certificate in yoga therapy in the works coming on the way. So I want to compare this to give you an idea of where this might be going to the field that I come from, which is the field of physical therapy. So the yoga therapy, by the way, the C-IAYT started in 1989, and that's till today, so what is that, 20-something years that's evolved? physical therapy over the course of 96 years. It started with a 300-hour certificate, rehabilitation aid. How many people are familiar with physical therapy? At least I've heard of it. So most people know what physical therapy is. Most people don't know what yoga therapy is yet. In fact, most of the patients that come to us in the Venice Family Clinic for yoga therapy have no idea what they're showing up for. And physical therapy started less than 100 years ago, yet almost everybody, it looks like everybody here, knows what it is. So it was reconstructionist aid. Then that became a 600-hour certificate, then a 1,200-hour certificate. Can you see the parallels here? It's almost identical. And then a bachelor's degree, and then a master's degree. And now the standard for physical therapy education in the United States is an entry-level doctorate degree. In fact, you can't get anything except you can no longer apply to a master's. It's only doctorate degrees. So how'd this come about? These are the first rehabilitation aids. This is the first class. It's evolved quite a bit. That came about because of World War I. So there was basically a need, just like lifestyle diseases, there's a need for yoga therapy. There was a need for somebody who knew and had skills on how to work with soldiers who were coming back with injuries. And then came the advent of the Salk vaccine. So people were living with polio now. And there were many people who were disabled, and they needed, again, somebody who had the skills and training that could help rehabilitate these people. And then from there came the World War II and the Korean War and the Vietnam War, many, many more soldiers coming home disabled. Franklin Roosevelt was he put out a mandate that special children needed to be able to contribute to society, and therefore he wanted people trained to be able to help them. As in addition, joint replacements, so people who knew how to work with that. So basically, it's the need that drove the evolution of physical therapy. So how about yoga therapy? So if anybody has seen this slide before, I did have to modify it. So thankfully, this slide had licensure for free use and modification for commercial use. It has a profanity in it. In regards to our program here, when Larry Payne started the Yoga Therapy RX program, in the 90s, here in Los Angeles and here in the United States, yoga, or I would call it yogasana classes, so basically yoga asana classes, became very popular. And with that, people started showing up in masses to yogasana classes, and many people were showing up with injuries. And unfortunately, many people were getting injured in yoga classes. So that's what kind of drove this need for education for yoga teachers to have understanding of musculoskeletal injuries. And thus, level one, that's what they were trained in, was to be able to work with people with injuries so that they could attend the classes. And then that evolved to our level two program that focuses on systems of the body, endocrine system, cardiovascular system, respiratory system. So people now with diseases come into classes, it's important that a yoga therapist has a strong fundamental education so they know, for example, no kumbhaka with someone who has emphysema because that could cause harm to them. Or perhaps they understand why you wouldn't do inversions with someone who has advanced diabetes. So there's a huge body of knowledge that a yoga therapist has to have. And then it evolved to our level three program that, as Larry said, was piloted at Samatha, which was the students who were learning more, these experienced yoga therapists, yoga teachers who were becoming yoga therapists, they wanted to know how to work one-on-one with clients. And this is most of the faculty here in our yoga therapy program. And they wanted to know how to work one-on-one. And so Larry Payne brought in, primarily from the Jessica Char lineage, experienced yoga teachers and yoga therapists who worked one-on-one with clients and had trained in India, and as well as physicians here, bridging that modern medicine and yoga so that they could learn how to work one-on-one with clients. And then it evolved to our level four program, which is the program that I had piloted with Larry in 2014. And we team up with the Sims-Mann Venice Family Clinic. And the Venice Family Clinic is the largest clinic for the underserved in the United States. So a large portion of our patients are actually homeless, and they have cell phones. So I found that really interesting because they don't have a change of clothes, they might not have a change of shoes, but they have a cell phone. And I was told that it's their lifeline. and that's why they have it. And so I find it's just really interesting how times have changed. In our level four clinic, when we started, and as you can, this is Paula Tapia, who's one of our graduates, and we work alongside allopathic medicine, chiropractic students, acupuncture students, and psychology as team members. And so they learn, as Larry said, they communicate in the medical records with soap notes, and they see patients one-on-one. When we started, they didn't know what yoga therapy was, and the doctors equated it with just physical postures. And so we started slow. We started with postures. We started with meditation, pranayama. Now we educate them on the Panchamaya model, and the doctor even is educating other doctors on the Panchamaya model because he thinks it's that important. And I see it in his notes when I read his notes. And we educate them on the gunas. And patients now, we went from having to basically beg for patients, and now we have a waiting list. And the reason is that patients that have filtered through the system receiving passive care, so chiropractic and acupuncture has helped them tremendously, but they didn't have anything they could do on their own. They weren't changing their lifestyle. And as somebody said yesterday, the medication doesn't help if you're not changing your lifestyle. And with changing your lifestyle, you don't need the medication or the herbs, the Ayurvedic herbs. Well, patients that have cycled through the system year after year, many of them are no longer cycling through the system because they've had really radical change through the yoga therapy. And this is our first graduating class. I know Ashley's here. Is anybody else here from our graduating class? Okay, so these are our graduates, and we're entering our fifth cohort next month. And I've seen a lot of, I'm actually going to skip to this one, is Amaji Bhavanani in Pondicherry. She creates a differentiation in yoga therapy between transformational and palliative. She runs the Ananda Ashram, and her son, Dr. Ananda Bhavanani, has been amazing contributions to yoga therapy. And we're actually, we're taking a group of yoga therapists to go visit and study there and at Kavalya Dham in December as part of the Education Yoga Therapy India trip. And so she breaks this down into palliative and transformational. And so a lot of the yoga therapy would be considered not palliative as in hospice palliative, but palliative as in practices that help reduce suffering. And so that's a lot of what might happen. Maybe there's some asana or pranayama that helps reduce suffering. However, I've witnessed transformation. So this is one of the patients I just want to highlight before I close out. This is Maureen Deering Davis, who is one of our graduates. She had been practicing as a yoga therapist for many years. She was in the first graduating class. She also has a deep practice of her own that I'll come back to in just a moment. This man here came to the clinic. He had been cycling through for at least 8 years, and he was homeless. He had chronic pain, severe thoracic pain. He had a club foot. He obviously had no job, no home, and he had severe depression. When a few weeks into our sessions, I noticed that he came in carrying a yoga mat. And he told us that he was given a $25 gift card to Target. And with it, he purchased a yoga mat because he learned in his yoga that his home is wherever his yoga mat is. So, yeah, transformation. By the end of his 12 sessions, he had a home. He had no pain, zero. It went from 10 out of 10, 8 out of 10, to 0 out of 10. And he got back to work and got back to his passion with his club foot back to surfing, and he was teaching surfing. So I would call that transformation. And we have so many more stories. There was a story, Ashley McKeachy's here, and there was another client that just sticks out for me, which is that, again, came from her. I believe it wasn't something necessarily that she learned. She took her information and it went in with what she understood. It was a patient who had chronic neck pain, and she'd been cycling through the system. And the pieces that I remember about this were that Ashley tuned into her because she was able to be present. As we learned yesterday, so much of it's about our presence with the patients, not just what we know, but how present we are, and was able to help the patient identify that her pain was worse at the end of the day, but it was worse around 5:30. Do you remember this patient, Ashley? When the pain, and I hope I'm getting this right, when her husband would come home, she had a lot of anxiety about her husband coming home. They had a lot of relationship issues. Anyway, cut to the chase, by the end of the time, she had no pain, and she and her husband were traveling together on his business trips, and she was teaching her husband pranayama. So this type of transformation is really getting to the root of where the suffering was coming from. And so I want to leave you with something here is that in educating yoga therapists, so much of it, there is a huge body of knowledge that they have to learn. And while I believe that that 1,000 hours that's the standard right now is just the tip of the iceberg, there's so much more that needs to happen. There's also yoga practice. And as BKS Iyengar says, it's not the number of hours that you have, but it's the quality of the practice. I think that yoga therapy, in order to maintain its soul and not just become with the illnesses that healthcare have, I work in physical therapy and I know the illnesses of my field, is the practice. So it's not like engineering where you might go learn a body of knowledge and then you go apply the body of knowledge, but you have to have a yoga practice. You have to have it within yourself. And as Shanti said yesterday, how you show up with the patient has a profound effect on the patient. So I think that's a uniqueness about this field, and I hope that in the future, as standards continue to evolve, that there is some credit given to the practice and how we monitor that, I'm not sure. But spirituality, and as Dr. Kumar mentioned about spirituality this morning, is while it's not in medicine, it is becoming interested in medicine. In fact, I had a slide I took out for time, but the majority of medical schools just a few years ago had no spiritual education as far as for their the physicians. Today, a majority, I think it's 90-something percent, have some type of education on spirituality because it's becoming understood, as well as empathy. It's shown that empathy decreases as a medical student goes through medical school, significantly decreases when they start to work with patients. Identifying that, the MCAT now has sections where they test students on compassion and empathy. So I think these qualities that we bring as yoga therapists are being recognized by the medical field, which gives it, makes it more inviting for us as professionals. So thank you.